time that, God, that we just worship you with an open and just loving mind and heart right now, God, Father, for we just want to receive more of you. And, you know, God, I thank you for everything. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.
Who am I that you are mindful of me, that you hear me when I call? Is it true that you are thinking of me, how you love me? It's amazing. That you are mindful of me, that you hear me when I call. Is it true that you are thinking of me, that you love me? It's amazing. God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. That you are mindful of me, that you hear me when I call. Is it true that you are thinking of me, how you love me? It's amazing. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. Church, let's sing that again. God Almighty.
God Almighty, Lord of glory, you have called me friend.
So amazing. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. God, he calls me friend.
I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God.
He calls me friend. He calls me friend. He calls me friend. He calls me friend. You were the word at the beginning. God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you our Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. Death could not hold you. The veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever. God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the glory. Yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. You know, I want to sing the bridge again. You know, I believe in that first sentence. It says, death could not hold you, and the veil tore before him. You know, I think it's so amazing that our King is alive today, that our God is alive today, and that he died for each and every one of our souls. So that means that we are important to him, and we are loved mightily by him. So let's sing that again with all of our heart, and let's believe that he is alive. Death could not hold you. The veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring the praise of your glory,
For you are raised to life again. You have no rival. You have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the glory. Yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus.
Amen. And you may be seated, church.
Anybody that is in jail, anybody getting out of jail, maybe somebody's family that has somebody in jail, whatever it might be, right down here at Greater New Lights Missionary Baptist Church at 9925 North 18th Street, right down here, big church on the corner. Every Tuesday night at 7 p.m., they hold church for guys just getting out of jail or family members. It's really good. Mark went last night. I had to miss because I was trying to put this together. And so I had to miss last night, but it's really good. We get to talk to a bunch of guys coming out. We get to meet them and their problems and things like that. I had a lady call me Sunday night. She called me Sunday night and said, "Hey, where's everybody at? Why aren't you at church?" It was Sunday about 6 o'clock. And I said, "Well, what are you talking about?" She goes, "Well, the biker church. Why aren't you here at the biker church?" So I want you to understand that that's the second Sunday of next month. It's August the 8th. We're going to have church here, and it's going to be a bunch of the Road Riders for Jesus. Juan's a part of that. And then we're also going to have the Grace Riders with us. And then that anybody that wants to come, you can come and have service with us. We'd love to have you. So what we're going to do tonight, if you want to open your Bibles to the book of James. There it is. Did you do that or did I do that? You did it? Okay. Man, I was going to say I'm better than I thought. So last week we talked about perseverance, and man, what a word, and what a time that we're in right now. Here at Calvary Chapel, we're just having to persevere just every day. We're just having to move through it every day. There's always something that we're working with here, and I know that in your life there's there's a lot of things that are going on in your life that you're having to persevere through also. So we learned about James. We learned that this is the first book in the New Testament ever written. And then we learned about perseverance. Perseverance is, I'm going to read it here. I don't have it up there, but I'm going to read it here. We're going to start right here on 2. And perseverance, a steady persistence in a course of action, a purpose, a state, especially in the spite of difficulties, obstacles, or discouragement. How many of us had discouragements in our life this week? Anybody read into any of that? Man right there says he has. Yeah. Yeah, we're going to talk tonight about how God moves us through them things. You know, it's funny how we sometimes when we're in all that stuff that we got going on in our lives, we try to work right through that stuff ourselves. We never even hit our knees. And we're going to talk about that a little bit tonight too, talking about perseverance and how where God wants us to do with that. So if you got your Bibles open, we're going to start right there in James. We're going to read, I'm going to read 1 through 5 because we stopped at 5 because, you see, I like to talk a lot. And last time I didn't get 5 verses in and nobody told me to quit talking. So we're going to start at 1, James 1, 1. Everybody there? Amen? All right, James 1, 1. James, a bondservant. Hello? Somebody say something? Oh, I thought I heard somebody say something. James, a bondservant of God and our Lord Jesus Christ. We talked about bondservant. We talked about how that goes about. To the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad. And we talked about the 12 tribes, how even Jesus noticed the Israelites as the 12 tribes. So he's talking about the 12 tribes and scattered abroad. We talked about that, how that's most likely from when they persecuted Stephen, that everybody just scattered. And that's what Bible scholars say. And that happened mostly probably in 31 to 34 A.D., James 1, 2, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials. And we talked about that. We talked about how not too many of us are jumping up and down when we fall into various trials and problems in our lives. I know I don't. I know I have trouble with the smallest things in my life, especially the biggest things in my life. James 1, 3, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. Huh? How many patience is like this? Now, be honest. Huh? How many patients are like that? Huh? Now, you be honest. And later on, we're going to hear how James says, you know, don't deceive yourself, brother. See? Because the Bible tells me that the ways of a man are right within his own eyes. See? So the better that I can get honest with myself, the more that I can get honest with myself, then the more that God can start working on me. Do you understand? Because when I'm not honest with myself, then I'm not honest with God at all. You hear what I'm saying? I need to work on my patience. I know a lot of us are running on empty. Knowing that the testing of your faith, where am I at, produces patience. Do I have one there? Okay, I'm seeing where I'm right here. I want to have some notes here, okay? And we talked about last week, we talked about how the purging with fire, that's what God's doing with us. When we're going through these things in our life, that's what he's doing. He's pulling stuff off of us. He's moving things off of us. And that's the purging. That's the working us like the gold. Have you ever seen them take that gold and they'll cook it up and then they'll put it in. They'll cook all the slack off of it. They'll get all that junk out. That's what God's doing with you right now and with me especially. He's getting all that nastiness out of me. He's heating me up. James 1:4, but let patience have its perfect work that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. And we talked about that. We talked about being perfect. Who in here is perfect? Huh? None of us is perfect, are we? Yeah, so he's not talking about being perfect. He's talking about being spiritually complete. He's talking about being full. He's talking about living in a way that is suitable to God. Okay? We all have trouble with that. Let's see here. We're going to go down to 5. James 1:5. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all liberally and without reproach, and it will be given to him. Now, we talked about this wisdom. You remember how we talked about how How that wisdom is learning how to apply what God has given you to your life. That's what wisdom is. He's not talking about making you the smartest person in the room. He's talking about when you pray to him, you're asking God to help me learn how to get through this situation. Do you see what I'm saying? Huh? He's not talking about the wisdom that's going to give you the idea to invent something to make you the smartest person in anything. He's talking about showing you how to walk through that situation that you're in right now. Huh? He says, if you don't know how to get through it, then you call on me and I will guide you through it. And he's going to treat each and every one of you the same way. He's not going to lead you through something that he's not going to lead you through. Do you understand what I'm talking about? He says, I give it to you all the same. See, but our problem is we want to walk through it alone. Our problem is I don't want to hit my knees and admit my part of it. Because usually that's the first part I have to do. I have to hit my knees and admit my part of it. My part right now is having a hard time with this earpiece. James 1:5. I think I do have one on here. James 3:13 is just a couple over. We looked at this last week. Who is wise and understanding among you? I ask you that. Anybody open their hand, say they're wise and understanding among you. Let him show by good conduct. Check that out. Let him show by good conduct. We blow that right off the bat. Huh? Let him show by conduct, by good conduct, what with that his works are done in the meekness of wisdom. How many of us know what meekness is? Huh? You don't know what meekness is? What is meekness? Meekness, an attitude or quality of the heart. You better read that. You better read that. What's your heart like, man? What's your heart like? That's what God's working with. He's not working with your mind. He's not working with your mind. I have a young man that comes by here all the time. He walks by here all the time. And he'll see me and he'll wave. He waves at me like this. He goes, hey, when I get my mind back right, I'm going to come to church. God's not working with your mind. He's working with your heart. God knows if he gets your heart right, then everything else follows right behind it. Do you hear what I'm saying? Huh? You get your heart right with God. I got my heart right with God sitting on a hot bunk in prison. I'll never forget it. And when I did, he took everything away from me. Whew, wiped it away. Because I'm hard-headed. I had to have that. Whew, took it all away at one time. I've never looked back. I've got my heart right with God. Am I perfect? No, I'm not perfect. But I know his instructions. I know what he's telling me. I know when to hit my knees and ask him, God, you got to help me here because I can't make it through this. I don't know what I'm doing. That's the wisdom he's asking us to have. That's what he's telling us to do. That's what James is telling us to do. I'm not the sharpest pencil in the box. I don't even know if I'm sharpened. But I know enough to hit my knees. Meekness, an attitude or quality of the heart whereby a person is what? Is willing to accept and submit without resistance to the will and desires of someone else. You think I'm talking about you to him. Yeah, it is talking about that. But I'm talking about me to him. Huh? How many of us submit to the will of him? That's what it's all about. When I get up in the morning and I say, Lord, you take this day and you walk before me. I give you my life today. You go before me. That turns it all over to him. That turns it all over to him. If you ain't doing that, you need to check yourself. And then quit taking it back in the middle of the day. Quit saying, I got it. I got this, Lord. We got to submit ourselves, not only to others, not only to my friends, but mostly to him. You see what I'm saying? We got to submit ourselves to him. I think I have one more on here. I'm not sure. I'm working between James 3:14. This is just a couple over. And I want us to look at the heart for a second. You remember last week when I was here last week and we talked about in Ephesians 1:14, how Paul's talking about giving you the spirit of wisdom and opening your eyes of understanding. Do you remember that? How many was here for that? That word understanding is talking about the heart. He's talking about your heart. It's translated heart. God is working with your heart. But if you have bitter envy and self-seeking in your heart, do not boast and lie against the truth. This wisdom does not descend from above, but it is earthly, sensual, and demonic. For where envy and self-seeking exist, confusion and every evil thing are there. Every evil thing is there. Therefore, having been justified, this is Paul writing. Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom also we have access by faith into the grace which we stand and rejoice in hope for the glory of God. I think I want to, where am I at? 5:3-5. I want to keep reading right here. And not only that, but we also glory in tribulations, knowing that the tribulations produce perseverance. And perseverance, character, and character, hope. I want to go down. I want to read one more. I want to go to 6. Let him ask in faith without doubting. For he who doubts is like the wave of the sea, driven and tossed by the wind. I want to talk about faith first, and I want to talk about that doubting. I want to talk about how we go about our prayer life and how we go about our lives ourselves. You know, a lot of us live in doubt. What is faith? Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Huh? You know, in John 3, it talks about how we get saved. It talks about how the Holy Spirit comes into our life like the wind. How that's talking about the sovereignty of God. It's talking about how powerful God is, that He can just move in your life and come into your heart on His own whim. Do you understand that? How many believe that? Huh? If that hasn't happened to you, you're not saved. See, that's talking about evidence of things not seen. That's exactly what he's talking about right here. I don't know how things work. I can't see a lot what my faith is, that I'm just standing on it. You understand what I'm saying? I'm just standing on it. I'm trying to work off two different ships here, and I apologize for that. So faith, let's see if I got another one up there on faith. Let's see. This is talking about the double-minded man. The double-minded, what he's talking about here is somebody that believes God, but is not trusting Him. Huh? How many of us are there? How many of us ever had that in our life? I believe in God, but I'm not trusting Him. Huh? That's exactly what he's talking about here. No one can serve two masters. Neither will he will hate the one or love the other. Or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. John 16:3 says, these things I have spoken to you, that in me you may have peace. And in the world you have tribulations, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. You got to decide what in the world you want to do with yourself. I tell that people all the time. When I go into prison all the time, I tell people all the time, you got to decide right now what you want to do with your life. Either you're going to stand strong right here where you're at, or you can go play games all day long. That's double-minded. We're going to talk, I think it goes in one more. He is a double-minded man. I think it's 7. Let's go to 7. James 1:7. For let not that man suppose that he will receive anything from the Lord. Huh. You wonder why ain't nothing happening in your life. Huh? You wonder why there ain't no change in your life. and you want to blame God. Huh? I'm just being real. I'm just being real. People go around asking God to do this and do that, and they're totally out of course with it. They're totally out of course with it. Let that man suppose that he will receive anything from the Lord. He is a double-minded man, unstable in all of his ways. Some Bible scholars call that a hypocrite. Huh? I didn't say that. But some Bible scholars say that if you believe there's a God and you don't trust him with everything you got, you're a hypocrite. You're a hypocrite. You're one of them that says, oh yeah, I'm a Christian. And then guess what? You're sitting in the bar about 8 o'clock drinking beer. Huh? That's the same thing. Is that not the same thing? A sin is a sin. You know, I talked about our hearts. I talked about, let me make sure I'm on the right page here. And I apologize for this. I usually don't mix my notes up like this. But you know, we talked about the hearts a while ago. I'll get it. And we talked about the hearts a while ago, and we talked about how that's what God's working with. That's what God's trying to get us to change. He's not trying to get us to change our minds. He's trying to get us to change our hearts. And, you know, about 5 or 6 months ago, right back there, I had a young lady come to me. She used to be a part of this church. She used to be a part of the worship team. And she came to me and she said, man, God is doing some mighty work in you, isn't he? She wasn't talking about my attitude. She wasn't talking about my mind. She was talking about my heart. She was talking about my heart. That's the biggest problem I have in my life is my heart and loving people the way I should love people. You know, I have to ask God to open the eyes of my understanding that I can see you through my heart instead of through my eyes. Do you hear what I'm saying? That I can look at you through my heart and not my eyes. Because when I look at you through my eyes, I want to judge you. When I look at you through my eyes, I want to fix you. But when I look at you through my heart, I want to help you. Huh? He is a double-minded man, unstable in all of his ways. James 1:9. Now here, James has given us two examples of trials, you know, and that word trials, it's the same word for tribulations. It's the same word. Now he's going to talk about a rich man. He's going to talk about a poor man. He says, "Let the lonely brother glory in his exaltation." What's he talking about? He's talking about you be happy because you're poor? Huh? Is that what he's talking about? Romans 1:17, and if children, then heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if indeed we have suffered with him, that we may also be glorified together. So what he's saying, what James is saying, though you ain't got anything, though you don't make much, though you don't have much, you glorify in what you got in Christ. Do you understand what I'm saying? He's all that I've got. I make less today than I made 10 years ago. I pay all my bills. I got a brand new motorcycle. He does more with me today than I ever dreamed I was going to do in my life. Do you hear what I'm saying? I'm a happy poor boy. And it's all because just trusting and leaning on Christ. It's all. For I consider that the suffering of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. He's saying you're going to get your payday. He's saying you're going to get your payday. You hang in there. You stick with it. You walk it out. And you're going to get your payday. I always talk about being justified, sanctified, and glorified. Huh? I'm justified by what he did. I'm sanctified by the work he's doing in me. And when he comes gets me, I'm going to be glorified. I'm going to get my reward. And that's what you have to rejoice in. That's what you have to rejoice in. This world is going to pass away. But every little note written in this right here, every dot and every little diddle, that's right. That's right. Every bit of it's going to come to pass. Every bit of it. We were talking about James a while ago, talking about ask of the Lord. And we were talking about prayer. And he just brung this to me. We were talking about prayer a while ago, and we were talking about when you go and you ask for wisdom, you ask boldly. And I talked about how people go to God and they ask for things, but they ask to miss. Okay? You're asking a miss. You're asking for things for your own worldly pleasure. And I want to tell you a little story about a man who went to a garden. He went to a garden to pray, and he took some guys with him. He took four guys with him, and he told them, y'all sit here, and I'm going to go over here and pray. And it says that this man went over here and he prayed to his father. And he said, God, he said, take this cup from me if you can. And if not, your will be done. And then he went back to the guys and they were asleep. He said, hey, wake up, man. At least you fall into temptation. He says, keep lookout. I'm going to go over here and I'm going to pray again. And he went back over there and he prayed the same prayer again. He said, Father, take this cup from me if you can. But if you can't, then your will be done. He prayed that prayer three times. That man was Jesus Christ. And that cup he was talking about the wrath of the world. That cup that he was talking about paying the price for the sins that you and me have laid upon him. And then they led him to the cross, and they nailed him to it. Some people say that he was trying to get out of it. He didn't want to do it. That ain't what he was doing. That ain't what he was doing. You keep reading, and it says that before he gave up that ghost, it says that he said, my God, why have you forsaken me? You see, at that split minute, when I read that sitting in prison, I could just picture God pouring out all my sins on Christ. I could just see him going, oh, oh, oh. He had to taste it. He had to feel it. At that second, he was separated from God. The only time in his life he was separated from God. Not just his life, not just the 33 years, but since the beginning. The book of John, it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God. All things are made through him and for him, and without him nothing was made that has been made. First time ever, he had to be separated from his Father. That's what he didn't want to go through. That's what he didn't want to happen. That's what he was afraid of. It wasn't paying the price for you and me, my sins, your sins. It wasn't that at all. That didn't bother me. Because Isaiah tells me right here, Isaiah says, let me see if I can find it. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He was led as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before the shears is silent, so he opened not his mouth. I'm telling you right now, they beat that man almost to death, and he never cried a word. How do I know that? It's right here. It's in this book. And if it's in that book, let me tell you, it's going to come to pass. And it happened. It says he didn't open his mouth. He didn't cry. He didn't mumble. He wasn't scared of taking the fall for me and you. He wasn't scared of taking the whipping for me and you. It says he didn't open his mouth. They beat that man almost to death. But you know they couldn't kill him? Can't kill God. He said, except I lay down my life, I rise it back up. They could have beat him another whole day. Couldn't kill him. When we go to God in prayer, we need to be bold. And we need to just hope. We need to pray that His will be done in our lives. Do you understand what I'm saying? You have to get yourself lined up with God. And you have to try to walk in His will. The Bible teaches me that fear of the Lord with contentment is great gain. Huh? When I'm content with where God has me in my life. I was talking to the team today. I was talking to them today about being part of this church. And how none of us should... I called them in the office. I wanted to talk to them, and I told them, look, whether we're out there making a sandwich for somebody, I'll tell you this. Jason was mowing the grass, weed eating, and there's two or three guys out here. I'm making sandwiches. Chrissy's making sandwiches. We're running back and forth taking care of these guys. Marilyn's cleaning up in here, and then we got the phone ringing, and we got people calling. This church is a busy church. And I brought them in the office. I said, I want to tell you, I'm proud to be a part of this team. And I don't want one of y'all to feel any lower than anybody else that works for this team. Whether you're making a sandwich, whether you're weed eating outside, or whether you're fixing the flat for somebody on down the road, it takes every one of us to run this church. And then we do it pretty smoothly, I do believe, because you know why? Because God's will is being done here. He leads, guides, and directs us. Because we wake up in the morning and we go to Him and we ask Him to have this day and that His will be done for us. I took my daughter to the doctor today. Y'all want to come up? We're going to do communion. I'm sorry. And I apologize for my notes being all messed up. I'll have it better next time. It's just been a busy week. I took my daughter to the doctor today, and as I was sitting there with her and waiting, I was out in the Brothers for Others bus getting the man some shoes, and Annette comes running up and says, it's 10 o'clock, you're late. I said, what? You're late, your daughter's appointment. So anyway, man, I'd fly over there to get her to the doctor. And when I'm sitting in that office, God revealed to me that that's the same way He loves me. That's the exact same way He loves me. How He throws everything down and comes running for me. Do you understand what I'm saying? He throws everything down and He comes running for you. And He might not answer it the way you want it answered, but He's going to answer it what is best for you. So when you go to God, you go to Him with boldness and you go to Him with His will be done and be content with it. We're going to do communion tonight, and I've had a lot of preachers say that you need to check yourself before you take communion, and that's right, you do. You need to check yourself. You need to ask the Lord to cleanse you, and that's right. But the reason Paul was really saying that was because the Corinthians were having a blast and eating, getting drunk and stuff before anybody else got there. They said Paul said you check yourself for why you're doing this. And that's the same way we need to check ourselves. So I'm going to give us a minute or two, and we're going to just sit quietly, and we're going to ask the Lord just to forgive us for whatever might be going on inside of our life right now, for whatever might be in our hearts that don't need to be in our hearts. Cleanse us, O Lord. The psalmist says, cleanse me, O Lord, and give me a pure heart. If y'all are ready, y'all can come up around this way and start taking your bread. get one, Brian? I'm going to read out of 1 Corinthians 11, 23, where they were having this trouble, and people were taking the communion for the wrong reasons. They were coming there and gorging on the food and getting drunk. Paul says that, and Jesus said himself, that we do this in remembrance of him. We do this in remembrance of him spilling his blood on that cross. We do this in remembrance of him going there and not opening his mouth, not complaining one time about being nailed to the tree for something that you and I did. You talking about love. He said there's no greater love than a man lay down his life for another. There's no greater love than a man lay down his life for another. Now, Paul says, I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, take, eat, this is my body. Which is broken for you, do this in remembrance of me. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink in remembrance of me. Leviticus 11:26 says, for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. By you receiving this, you're saying that I believe that you are who you say you are. I believe that you have something waiting for me in days to come. You say that you believe that he was nailed on that cross for your sins and my sins. I want to pray over us, and then we're going to be dismissed. Father, we thank you. We thank you for all that you do for us. We thank you for your Son, Father, who was nailed to that cross and never muttered one word. Father, we thank you for that love that he just continues to pour out on us, even when we don't deserve it, even when we fail him, even when we say, I did it again. Father, we just thank you for the love that you continue to pour out on us. We give you all praise and glory in our lives, and we ask that you just lead, guide, and direct us, not only tonight, but tomorrow, and the next day, until we see you coming riding in on that cloud. We give you all praise and glory. In Jesus' name, amen.